across the projects, depending on the way they had roles, that is the way they were doing their cross-site boundary spanning. This is number one. I'll move on to number two. Now again, I think the figure that I have over here, this again must be very common. I mean, I'm sure all of you must have come across this change request that come in. The moment all of you are practicing Agile, there are change requests. I mean, it could be product, it could be services, the fact that you have a client, there will be one or the other change request through the course of development. And I think a lot of discussion in the Agile community is how do you then handle change? What do you do to ensure that teams are least affected with the change that is coming in? And this is what leads me to the second pattern that we observed on the field. And I think this is the figure that I have for you then. Again, I think when it comes to code ownership, Mr. Martin Fowler, the chief scientist at ThoughtWorks, he came up with a very good classification. He said there are three ways in which the codes, in which the software, the ownership can take place. The first one being, of course, you have collective code ownership, which is what extreme programming, one of the principles over there are. The other approach he talks about was weak individual code ownership, where he said that, look, on a given code base, there has to be accountability, there has to be responsibility. Now, if we are going with a weak individual code ownership, then one particular individual is accountable for the code base, but the responsibility lies with the entire team. The third model being, you are looking at a strong individual code ownership. That is when you say one particular individual is accountable as well as responsible for the code base which we have. So now these are three models that are out there. One is obviously the collective code ownership, the weak individual code ownership, and then the strong individual code ownership. Now, depending on what kind of code ownership that exists in a setup, that will have a bearing on the way you have the teams participating in the formal meetings. Now, what we found, if we have something like collective code ownership, which is what I think extreme programming practicing teams are looking at, then probably you need not have everybody in the team participating in the formal meetings. I mean, it's fair enough to say that, hey, all of us are aware of the code base because we are owning it collectively. Then you can have relevant team members coming for the formal meetings like your sprint plannings or your reviews or even the, I think, retrospective is more team-based, so I'll leave that out. The other model being if you are having very weak individual code ownership where, you know, you're saying that responsibility is with everyone but accountability is with one particular individual, then probably you need the entire team to participate in the formal meetings, be it your plannings or the reviews. So this is the sort of two distinct models that we found in the setting. So the way you define your code ownership, that had a bearing on the team participation in the meetings. And this is what I'm referring to as the effective pattern number two.
I have a question here.
Sure.
If you have a team, should, the entire team should not be there as a standard.
Okay. So one thing that we found in the field was, if the teams are having collective code ownership, the fact that the accountability, responsibility was being shared. And again, I mean, the fact that whenever we found this collective code ownership, invariably the teams were also practicing extreme programming. So then you had this concept of pair programming also coming in. So the moment you have pair programming and the fact that you follow pair rotation, so effectively the entire team was well aware of the code base because, I mean, you keep rotating pairs. Today it's A and B, tomorrow it's A and C, tomorrow it's B and D. So a lot of people are sort of completely aware of the code base, where probably everyone was so well aware of the code base that probably people were well versed to tackle questions from the client. No, they can. I mean, I'm not saying that they cannot, but if I'm talking about the effective patterns, then depending on the way your code ownership, that should drive the way you have the participation. So again, I'm not talking about a mutually exclusive scenario that if you have collective code ownership, keep people away from the meetings. That is not what I'm getting onto. But effectively what I'm saying, if you have collective, then you can follow that kind of a model where you say that, okay, we need not involve everybody in a formal meeting. If there are other important work, people can stay out.
So is that a pattern you saw in the ground?
Right. That's a pattern.
That's a pattern they found.
Yes.
And the programming paradigm they use is extreme programming.
Right.
That's why it's different from the front.
It's not about which is right or wrong.
Yeah.
It's
how the
pattern which is.
Yeah. Thank you.
I have a question here.
Sure.
I just want to understand how many data samples you collected for this.
I'm sorry, come again.
How many data you collected?
Okay, so again, as we said, we are looking at 8 projects across product development and services focused organizations.
I'm very specifically asking about this.
Okay, yes, there was. In fact, we also participated in the meetings to observe now in what form are the team members participating. Do we have the entire team participating in it? If not, then what would be the rationale? So we sort of backed our interviews with also the kind of observation we had in meetings as well. Yeah.
Was there
another? Yes, there was. But I think it varies across settings. So but we made it a point to be there in planning reviews, daily stand-ups, and all of that.
Another question which I had,
sure.
As you just said, you can have a customer knowing line number 11 is a problem. Can you explain a bit more on that?
No, not line number 11, but probably line number 26 to 30. That's what precisely I meant. So effectively what we are saying is that, again, I'm trying to exaggerate the point over there, but what I want to make out is that if there is an issue that a customer sees, or if there is a bug that a customer spots saying that, okay, this is not looking that great, then the people who are there on the table, either they are aware or they should be in a position to reply to them. So that is being the whole point. Yeah.
Yeah, so the question we answered, does customer look at the lines of code?
That's a big thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It does not happen. Customers
yeah.
do not look
okay.
at the code.
Okay.
Customers look at the product.
Okay. Now, I mean, in the services setting, we do have some more scenarios where you have a very tight control over the vendor, where you're saying. So we did find that in a couple of services setting.
Okay.
Product
it's
setting.
It's an extreme
land
case
yeah.
where XP is,
right.
And that's what Priyank is pointing
right.
out. How many samples you get? Because we don't see that quite often.
Right.
I would definitely go by number of
Yeah.
Okay.
Is a valid question.
Okay.
Yeah, it's very
sure.
extremely rare that you find a customer looking at line number codes and
right.
pointing it out. Plus, option of not team participating in all the events. That's something which is not a pattern which is actually seen. And that's
okay.
the reason why he's asking.
Okay,
yeah.
I'll take that. Yeah. So moving on. Again, I think coming to the third pattern that we have over here. Again, I think this is something that I think all of us have experienced, be it whichever format, the products or services. What we are saying over here is effectively that, you know, I mean, if we have to increase velocity, what can we do? So this is one of the common solutions that the software teams have. Again, to rig the setup in whichever form that you can, you say that we'll come up with bigger estimates to sort of hike up the velocity. So in this kind of a scenario, what we found, because we are studying distributed agile format, it becomes critical what kind of visibility do you maintain on work progression. Now, if you are looking at this kind of format, there will be an issue with the way you maintain visibility. Effectively, what we found is that in such scenarios, teams are not comfortable sharing trends, or they say that, okay, let's keep it internal to a given setting and let's not, you know, divulge details to our cross-site counterparts. And so the way you maintain visibility, of course, I think the storyboards are all virtual everywhere now, so there is no way where, you know, you will not well, you will not maintain the status of the task that you are executing. I think that is something that was clearly visible across sites. Where you say this many stories are being implemented, these many are in process, and these tasks have been done. But there were sites which say that, hey, we will not flag dependencies, or we will sort of stay away slightly from that. And of course, the trends were something that teams were not clearly comfortable divulging in some of the scenarios. Now, depending on whichever way you maintain visibility across work progression, that will have a bearing on the way you handle your meetings, specifically coming in from the time management aspect. Now, some of the scenarios what we found, which maintain complete visibility, which are completely transparent, they had precise time management of meetings. I mean, effectively, the managers and everyone had a clear view of what is being presented. So then the team said that here is the set agenda that we have for discussion in a meeting. Teams used to come bang on time and they used to end bang on time. The other scenario where teams were saying that, okay, you know, there is a partial visibility, we are not too sure. Then there were a lot of cross questions that were happening. Hey, what happened? Were you able to finish that many stories? Was your velocity this much or wasn't it that much? In those kind of scenarios, then there was more an open-ended kind of a discussion. And then that what that entailed was, I mean, an overflow in the time, the time specified for the meeting. And that is one pattern that we observed. The way you maintain visibility of work progression across sites, that will have a bearing on the way you manage times for some of these formal meetings, be it the plannings or the reviews. Now coming to the final pattern, again, this is something that again I'm sure that all of you must have come up with. But this is where it comes down to how a developer looks at what he's executing. Now we all of us can look at a developer who says that, okay, you know, I produce these 15 lines of code, which is the big thing that needs to be done. Whereas in other form, we can also have developers who say that, okay, you know what I mean, let me be more helpful to the other people who I have on the team. And maybe, you know, the lines of code that I produce is not the yardstick that I need to be judged against. So this leads me to the fourth pattern that we have, the amount of work effort that you're sharing within a given team. In the scenarios where you found there was a lot of shared discretionary work effort, where people were sort of collaborating on tasks, they were not being measured by a yardstick, each of the developer was not being measured by a yardstick, then across sites what they had is they had a dedicated representative. So in fact, in one of the scenarios we had someone like a distributed representative particularly stationed at that site, so that we can take queries from the teams sitting at the other location. So this is another interesting pattern where the way you sort of share the responsibilities at a given team. So there are two patterns again over here. One being you can be very precise or you can be a lot flexible. And I think that needs to then have a bearing on whether you will have a representative across site or not. If you are sharing it, then you can have a dedicated representative. If you are not, where you say that, okay, this is what we are doing, then probably you will be sending out those emails to the specific developers trying to get your queries answered. It could be technical leads, scrum masters, and whoever it's there on the other side. So these are the ballpark four patterns that I had. Now, before I conclude, I would like to emphasize the key takeaway from this presentation. And I think we have a lot of managers sitting here, so this will be interesting for them. I think as managers, if you are managing a distributed agile effort, there's a need to then reassess the project context in which the effort is being executed. Now, what I showed across these four patterns, if I were to synthesize, there is some kind of synchronization that happens in the way you manage performance in your team and the way you handle your cross-site relational aspects with the team who is sitting across site. So I think the first element that I had on all these four patterns were more the performance aspects. The way you own your code, the way you sort of maintain visibility of the work that you are doing, the way you specify a role in a given software team, and the way you have a discretionary work effort in a given software team. So the way you manage your performance, that will have a bearing on the social aspect. The way you span the boundary, the way you have mutual responsiveness across sites, the way in a meeting, how many team members will participate, what will be the time management of those. So there is the synchronization between your performance and the social aspects. So this is what that came through from the research, and this is something that I would want to give out to all of you, that please assess the project context. There might be some low-hanging fruit over there for you to improve the setting that you're working on. So that's it from my end. I'm open to questions, queries. Thank you. Yeah. Sure.
Because what is feedback on developer ownership to create ideas? Because we aim at that, but eventually all of them taking the responsibility, making the work to complete, might not work out. We see, the work has to be done, so then the individual ownership comes. Someone picks it up. Developer ownership might be very idealistic, so that's why I just want to understand.
Okay, I see your point, but surprisingly we didn't. But effectively, then what we found in the settings was, if you are not having collective ownership, then there is a difference in the way you sort of have people involved in the meetings. So effectively, in fact, there were quite a few settings which didn't have collective ownership. There was weak individual code ownership that was being followed. And then effectively what people said is, we will have everybody on board when it comes to the planning and reviews. They were being formalized, where you say that everyone has to be there in these meetings. So I see the point that you're raising. Yeah.
Did you see any difference when you had the manager or the lead sit in one geography versus another geography in these teams when it's together?
Okay. Now I think specifically there can be. I'll probably say in one or two of these projects there was such cases. But when we sort of synthesize, we then sort of say that one setting can be an exception, but across the seven settings, if you're seeing a phenomenon, that is the pattern that we are reporting over here.
In the real scenario, distributed agile teams. So the agile teams have different compositions and spread across the team. So how do you bridge the gap between the process that each of the team follows? Because even within agile, there is a process, and individual teams follow different processes. So how do you bridge the gap?
So one thing that we had common across these eight projects in terms of how they were managing the project, they were following Scrum. So at a team level, Scrum was being followed across all these projects. So the fact that we were looking at same set of ceremonies or artifacts being followed. But the fact that yes, there are variations as you pointed out. But again, that is the reason where we sort of say that in our research design, we'll stick to one particular pattern. So the pattern that we wanted to follow was to ensure that teams are following Scrum. And then when I pointed out the reasonable agile process maturity, where, so we didn't go in saying that, okay, this is the buzzword that we are looking at. I mean, are you following Kanban way of, you know, I mean, handling things or not?
Even IT routines are following Scrum mostly. Uh-huh. The week ownership or the collective ownership. So within the Scrum, they might be following different patterns.
Right.
And from the management point of view, you might be expected of a result, and there are different ways that both the teams work to, you know, get that result. So, how do you manage that synchronization?
Right, right. I think absolutely. So, as I mentioned, I mean, so for each of the pattern that I presented, there can be two scenarios. I mean, effectively, I mean, sticking to the example of code ownership, you can have collective or you can have something like weak individual. Now, strong individual is something we are not seeing in the agile world because that is very much the waterfall way of doing things. So, but depending on whichever way where you are, it could be collective, it could be weak individual, that will have a bearing on the other side of things. Be it, again, in this case what I was talking about is team inclusivity in meetings. So if you're having weak individual, then the effectively the pattern that we saw is maybe you need everyone to be on board when you have these meetings. Whereas if you're having collective, then it might be alright to say that, okay, you know, we can let go of some of the developers when it comes to the meeting. Yeah.
So I have one question. So within this do you find any pattern that where, let's say, that organizational or culture is somehow either enabling or inhibiting the progress agile?
Yes, there was. In fact, I think that's a very interesting question. But I mean, when we go about conducting research, we try to sort of control for some of the variables. So again, I mean, this is not a variable we can control. I mean, culture is something that is driven by the organization. But the fact that we said that, okay, now that is not something that we are going to go into. But through our interviews, we realized that some organizations who sort of imbibe agile in the way they do things, I mean, they were a lot more fluid. Again, I mean, the organizations will then be having collective ownership. They will be, you know, sort of XP, the principles of XP were being followed. So yes, of course, I think I concur with you. That will have a bearing on the way agile is being followed. And then, of course, the way distributed agile is being followed. But again, I think we were selective with the way we decide our cases so that, you know, that doesn't become a factor. So any project where we found that there is not a reasonable agile process maturity, we sort of let go of that, saying that we'll not study this. So, yeah.
Sure. So in India, US,
Right. Now, I mean, in fact, we didn't follow a model where you have a dispersed team sitting across three locations. We had complete teams sitting out of one location or another. So we were not looking at those models where you have a team in itself dispersed across three locations. So you have a complete software team sitting in India, and you have another complete software team sitting somewhere in the USA. Right.
Yeah, that was my fundamental question. When you say distributed agile,
right,
is the team co-located or are you talking about number of teams?
Right.
Functioning in different locations.
Right. Now again, I mean, as I showed in the basic setup, the idea is we are looking at co-located teams. We are looking at the entire team working from one location.
The practically, we will not find many of them. All of them are one team with couple of developers here, couple of developers US, tech lead there, product owner there, testers in a different location. That's the scenario. Probably, you know, that's a practical setup.
Yeah, even within the same city.
Yeah,
within the same city, we have different locations.
It's very difficult to get.
I mean, on the contrary, that's the reason where we said that we'll enter the large MNCs. Again, I'm not sure which organizations we are referring to, but the organizations where we entered, we said that these will be the large MNCs who effectively make it a point, who have the resources to ensure that the teams are at a location where they do not go for sprinting of resources. So,
the fundamental goal of agile is lost if we have a development team in India.
Right, and in fact that is the reason where we went to the co-located agile teams, where we said that we will not have those models where you have teams dispersed.
But that's how it is. In services industry, you will find all the projects having your product owner sitting in US,
right,
technical
right.
Architects will be in US.
Right.
Your business analyst probably will be
here. Right. Okay, let me make a clarification. What I am referring to distributedness here, it's more of the development teams. I understand that your product management group can be entirely out of USA. But then the moment you talk about large MNCs, we are looking at projects which are being executed by say 6 to 8 software teams, of which you have 3 sitting in India and 3 sitting somewhere in USA.
Yeah.
So you'll have the product management group that is separate of the development teams that you have. Yeah.
So actually, you are actually talking about scaling.
Are you sending a message to me or to us like it's all informal here?
Okay. Okay. Again, I think that's more to bring out the distinctions between the way you look at agile and the way you look at distributedness. Of course, I understand it's not like we say that, okay, you know, I mean, there is no control in the setting. I mean, you do have a project manager sitting with an agile team who is sort of ensuring that things are being moved as per plan. But compared to a distributed sort of a format where, you know, there is a more when you're saying that, okay, we need to give out this deliverable by this and this date, so I want developer 1 to work on this, developer 2 to work on this, that's not the model that we're looking at in Agile. So that's more to bring out the distinction between the two slides.
The intention behind, if I'm not wrong, and I'm just using the references of one of the co-creators of this whole Agile movement, I believe there's a lot of discipline expected rather than informalness expected in the Agile teams, right? So, we expect the people to take up the ownership and self-manage themselves, right? Which is, in a different word, we are talking about, you know, what you are saying is, and I'm not differing on your input on code or collective ownership. I'm just interested to know, because you are a researcher, and we are like super busy in the AC offices. I thought like you will have the data, so we can use that, and I can still into my customers. So I couldn't get the success though. So my intention to ask you this question is because that's what his intention is, and that's what they say is the collective code ownership is an exemplar of self-organizing team. You cannot dictate that term, as Ashish directly said. You have the opportunity where you can differ on that principle number one of collective code ownership.
Right.
And then on top of it, my interpretation and that use of the informal word defining that is like, you know, you have a lot of responsibilities transition to the team members. That's what the intention is. And we're talking about distributed, it means a little more than that.
Right.
You have a cultural diversity in there, right? So you may have to expect that how they deal with the German guy and then how they deal with another continental guy in the US or maybe an Australian guy, because they all bring in different culture onto the table. And we expect different behavior from them for a particular circumstance. So how that relates over there, let's say I have a member who is in US and one is in Germany and one is in Australia, and then how do you use that example? Like, I'm not relating.
Okay, I think I'll have to take that offline because that would be a long discussion, because every project had its own idiosyncrasies when it comes down to, you know, what kind of cultural boundaries we are looking at over there. So I'll take that offline with you.
The distributed for us, if I'm not wrong, is that.
Right, I'll take that for sure. But effectively, the fact that the way we define, I define distributed agile over here, we are looking at multiple geographies, agile teams, co-located, working. That is the setup that I am talking about over here. Yeah. So I think I'll stick to that. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot, Aksha, for your presentation. This is a small moment of appreciation from our side.
Thank you.
Thanks again for the picture. Thank you. So this next talk, and the topic is going to be leadership agility, the exigent demands of the VUCA world. So can we have Mr. Preet, please?
So today, I'll start off with a small introduction about myself, Preet. I work as an independent agile consultant. I coach, but I still think the word coach really doesn't apply to the job that I do. But consultant, because I don't coach people, I go in and help them choose the right solution for them. It's not evolving from there. So, having said that, I've been with Agile for some time. I would claim that I know Agile very well, right? And leadership is one area which I've been concentrating on recently, primarily because of all